Unalakleet, everything used to be white, you know, a lot of snow. You can even go on top of the houses because there was so much snow almost covered. Today, the third lane snow seems like every year it gets worse, not cold anymore.
Most folks are in agreement that climate change is caused by human impacts to the environment. And I think, you know, we are part of the problem even out here in rural Alaska because of our dependence on fossil fuels.
Climate change seems to be happening fastest in the north, and there's very good reasons for this. As the growing seasons become longer and the snow melts earlier, as the sea ice begins to melt, then this changes the surface of the north from being a white covered surface to a dark covered surface for more of the year. This means that the land and the sea absorb more energy and transfer that to the air, causing the air to become warmer. So the net result of all of this is that the north warms fastest and warms to a greater degree than is happening anywhere else on the planet.
How is climate change affecting Alaskans? Well, throughout Alaska, people are seeing changes in the places where they live.
We're standing on Kaik Mountain, and we're near the site of where we would like to relocate. And the village is down here near the river. This river coming this way on the north side is the Kaikuk River, and it meets up with the Yukon River. When we have flooding, it jams down here about 6 miles down, and there's a curve in the river. And all the ice backs up all the way up to Kaikuk, and the ice jams, then the ice comes backwards, and it comes over the banks, and it goes into the low areas, into the sloughs and the creeks.
There's some very concrete steps that communities can take to adapt to climate change. First, communities can get their members together and talk about what they've seen around them, because the things that are happening around them are the things that are likely to become more pronounced in the future.
Kaikuk is a pretty active community. Community members really participate in community planning meetings. We have different ways of organizing meetings. We plan it around dinners. Like if we have a particular project identified, like with the plans, we organize committees or a working group, and that seems to work really good.
Individuals within communities would be very pivotal in getting things started within that community. Certainly the first thing to do would be to hold a community meeting, start monitoring the issues, document the issues, taking photos during the storm season, taking photos of some of the changes that are taking place.
Communities can think about the changes they've seen and the sorts of risks that these changes create for them.
We're in an area of Homer that has, in the last 60 or 70 years, experienced very high erosion rates. The bluff above us here 50 years ago would have been almost 300 feet seaward of where we're standing right now. Just based on what we can observe in the patterns of erosion, it looks like most of the erosion here is caused by storm energy, by waves hitting the base of these bluffs, probably during big storms coming out off the open gulf here behind us.
The most striking impact of climate change has been the spruce bark beetle outbreak. Starting in 1987, we went into overdrive with warm summers, and this really went through 1997. And even though there were some cool periods in there, relatively speaking, the temperatures never went below average. The bark beetles were able just to continue eating through this warm period until they had eaten themselves out of house and home. From our tree ring investigations, we think that this run of warm summers has been the longest run in the last 400 years.
When we started seeing higher temperatures back in 2002, we were looking at temperatures that were starting to exceed 20 degrees Celsius. 20 degrees is about 68 degrees Fahrenheit. So you'd notice that as a fisherman, you'd notice that that was nice water to stand in as you were fishing. And so we were surprised to see that we actually had temperatures that were that warm, because that's stressful for fish at both the egg stage as well as when they are migrating upstream as adults.
Permafrost really has a controlling effect on the landscape as well and on the wetlands, because underneath a lot of these wetlands and lakes, you actually have permafrost. As that permafrost degrades and gets deeper and deeper, what it does is it lowers the water table, shifting from this aquatic kind of environment to more of a terrestrial type of environment. Within the next 50 years to 100 years, what you're going to see is a complete loss of permafrost out here on the Delta.
We don't know if a 1 degree average temperature during the summer period, for example, may give the invasive species the upper hand on outcompeting our native species. We're worried about those kinds of issues. Water coming from the atmosphere, acid rain basically, is also an issue that may change the overall pH of the surface waters where these animals are living.
We've seen several parts of our community having problems. We've seen the river mouth erosion from the large volume of water that goes in and then has to come back out. The fence that surrounds the airport collapsed in every storm. We've seen the water transmission line that's 5 miles north of the village exposed from erosion. Our evacuation road was underwater in 2005. And those are all problems that have come from the fall storms.
This is the flood gauge for Kaikuk. It's on the Washateria building. And there's different markers on the gauge showing the level of the different facilities around town. And this one is the level of the old bulk field facility at 7.5 feet. And the old power plant building is at 10.5 feet. The old airport is about 10.5 feet. This is about the level that water comes to right here.
Well, it's affecting a lot because this pond right here we're standing on, it's a popular gathering place for greens. The women come out and pick greens. A lot of our ponds are drying out. We have to go out further. Gas is expensive. And not only that, you can see behind me there's hardly any snow. A few days ago it was raining. So it's affecting everything. Our hunting, our wood gathering, anything that we do in the village, it's really being affected by this global warming.
Communities can think about their goals and what they really want to maintain in their communities and how they can achieve these goals given the changes that are occurring around them.
People are harvesting large amounts of sea mammal and they need to have good storage. They've been able to put the whale meat and whale blubber into the permafrost frozen ground. Traditional underground food cellars. From a standpoint of food security, the thawing of the ice cellars is causing a shortage of food for many Arctic communities.
When summertime does come, we have extremely high temperatures. You know, the water starts evaporating and the water levels goes down. So us, we don't go up river with too shallow to even go up to our hunting areas. So it's a year-round cycle of misfortunes because of climate changes.
Communities can begin to think about plans that they might wish to develop that enable them to achieve their vision in light of the changes that are occurring.
In looking for ideas and solutions for how to adapt to climate change, some people are conducting monitoring programs.
This invasive tunicate right here. What we're doing here is monitoring for the presence of invasive tunicates. And the Smithsonian Environmental Research Center initiated a project in which we monitor what we call settling plates underwater. They're clean plates when we put them down, and they colonize with organisms that are floating in the marine environment here. And if there are invasive species, such as the tunicates we're worried about, then they will populate those plates. And indeed, we've found quite a few of those tunicates on the plates that we've been monitoring here. We look at every organism. We determine the percent coverage of the plate by each of the different types of organisms. And if there is invasive species there, such as the Botryloides invasive tunicate that we're finding here, we take samples of those. We send those samples down to San Francisco area. They do DNA analysis in which they're able to identify the original source. They are not presenting a problem on the waterfront here currently, but we think under the conditions of warming environment, warming seawater, that they may very well become a threat to our native species of shellfish, and especially a problem associated with the shellfish industry and a mariculture industry in the southern southeast region.
So we know that warm water is stressful for fish and makes them more susceptible to predation, pollution, and disease. We don't have the information to understand how productive our watersheds are. We do a lot of looking at the movement of adult salmon into the watershed, but in most cases we don't really understand how many of the juvenile salmon leave the system. Hopefully with more regional look at temperatures, that will help resource managers and communities focus on where that type of research needs to happen. We also focus our efforts at streamside protection. We can help reduce the solar input into the stream by great riparian streamside vegetation. And so on streams that are starting to show some stress in terms of their water temperature, if we can improve streamside protection for the vegetation, that might help slow down the warming process in some of those systems.
We're looking at 5 different categories of health effect in Alaska. And the way we categorize them is illness, both acute disease, such as might occur from a food poisoning event, and also chronic illness, diet changes, whether it's going to change rates of diabetes or heart disease. We also are looking at injury rates resulting from changes in transportation and changes in behavior. Food safety and security and water safety and security are also big issues. And finally, mental health. As the environment changes, what kinds of new stress and new obstacles are emerging that are going to affect people's behavioral health?
Communities can think about the resources that they need to implement their vision and work with people both within their community and beyond their community to find these resources and implement their goals.
Unalakleet has come up with several ideas for adapting to the environmental changes occurring in their area.
We're encouraging migration to the hillside. You know, we've all recognized that this area down here is perhaps in our lifetime may not even be down here, and we're encouraging new development to happen up on the hillside.
You know, Steve Ivanov, he has called together community meetings where he'll come to Anchorage and he'll call people up and call representatives from different agencies and have them sit down and talk to each other at the table. There's nothing to stop communities from doing this. These agencies have a responsibility. They have to deal with these communities. So if a community goes and asks them to come and meet, most of them are going to come and meet.
We come up with a priority list. The community has their comprehensive plan with their priority list. The tribe has their transportation plan, which we created. We conduct subcommittees to identify all the projects that are basically on their wants list. Once the list is completed, then we prioritize in that order. And both the city and the tribe had this erosion project near the Rivermouth as the number one priority. And of course, elevating the beach road west was another one that proved to be a real good call on the priority system, because from the flood of 2009, elevating the road a month before the flood stopped a lot of water from the ocean from making it into the residences.
Sometimes these changes are just small things that you can do in terms of just changing the time that you do things, changing the way in which you do things, changing, deciding that you're going to do it on your own rather than waiting for somebody else to make it happen.
Kaikuk had a wildfire assessment done. We were rated high by the State Division of Forestry. We've had several fires in the area before, and we have a lot of dry spruce that has a potential of threatening the village. During the study, we've looked at the best place for a fire break. This area right here from the airport all the way up to the rock quarry will be the fire break.
Adaptation to a different climate will require a shift in some aspects of everyday life, but some of this change could hold new opportunities.
We all want the same thing. We all want a sustainable resource. We all want the salmon to keep coming back. We want our kids to be able to fish for salmon. We want our grandchildren to be able to fish for salmon. So we might see a shift in the species that are being targeted, such as more utilization of whitefish or pike as, you know, maybe there are fewer subsistence opportunities for salmon, you might see people starting to shift to other species.
Here in Unalakleet and adjacent villages in eastern Norton Sound, we've seen higher intense storms and more frequent. The hope is that the people will be allowed to progress to the hillside with their own resources.
I don't believe that government's going to solve this problem for us quickly enough. Things are happening, they're happening fast, and the communities are the places where people see these changes, they understand these changes, they understand the consequences of these changes. So it's a place where action by people in their own communities is going to make the biggest difference.
Nobody is more familiar and more knowledgeable about their communities than the people that live there. And the people that live there have a historical perspective on change in that community. The better that they can articulate that, the better off they are in acquiring funding to have somebody come in and professionally do an assessment.
We're preparing to move the village if it gets worse. There's a proposal out for a 15-mile road up our river. After looking at what the other villages are going through, we'd rather be prepared than do a last-minute deal.
And we're taking action and making efforts to do things to help us adapt. You know, we got 700 plus people out here that are dependent on the decision makers of the community to go out and seek ways that we can, you know, save energy, for example, or have a better home which would withstand the weather conditions that we're being faced with, you know, with climate change occurring on all around us.